Hey guys, what's going on? It's Ash here coming at you today in Raid Shadow Legends. Welcome to the video, guys. How are you all doing? Today, I'm going to take a look at this dude, the simple champion whose name is not simple. He's simple, whose name is actually Alexander, the sharpshooter here. I got to hand it to Plarium. They looks aesthetically better than Ninja, especially on the mug, especially on the face, man. Let's look at these two champions side by side. In today's video, I want to talk about whether or not the rankings, so the reviews in this champion, are justified. Is he this bad? Ones and twos across the board? Is he this bad? Today we're going to talk about that. But first off, yeah, at least his face looks like the dude. Simple. Whereas, I feel like for Alexander the Sharpshooter, they're like, let's spend extra time making sure he looks properly, looks good, but then let's skimp on the stats. And for Ninja, they were like, wow, we're just gonna put this out there because we don't have extra time to work on the graphic imagery on the face there.
Do you want me to cry? Is that what you want? Do you want to see me cry?
Instead, let's give him an OP kit instead, right? Both of these champions are these limited time logins, 7 days over a 2 month period or whatever it is, and you get this champion, this legendary champion, okay? So here's the weird thing, right? I could easily, the thought occurred to me when I was kind of prepping for today's video, how do I feel about this champion, right? Because I can make a very strong case that this dude is just trash on trash on trash, awful, pretty much for everybody. Or I can make a very compelling case that he's a great addition to the game, especially for free-to-play or low spenders or players just starting the game. Just to kind of be a contrarian about it because everybody's hating on this champion. And I'm not sure which one I believe. I'm just being real with you guys, right? Because let's quickly look at his kit and then I'll share a little bit more on each side. I'm gonna play both sides of the fence here for you guys transparently. And then I want to hear from you guys what you think of this champion. On his A1, he has a freeze. On his A2, he has an AoE decreased defense. And then, like, he's doing either weaken or he's doing a higher percent chance at putting a freeze on orcs and ogren tribe. I don't know about you guys, but when I read an ability like this that is, you know, geared towards or works only against one or a few different factions, I just pretend it's not even there. I just ignore it, man. Because, sure, if it works, if it helps, it's a bonus. Fantastic. But if it doesn't, I mean, you can't count on it. Who goes against only ogrens and orcs, right? And who's, you're not going to be that guy. Subbing Alexander the Sharpshooter in and out based on the affinity of the arena team that you're matching, or excuse me, the faction of the arena team that you're matching against, right? I mean, no one's going to do that. So what do we care? Born to Win, his A3, attacks one enemy, removes all buffs from the target. Hey, he removes the buffs before attacking instead if they're an ogren or an orc. Really, you couldn't have made that ability? You couldn't have made that ability just remove him before anyway. Plenty of champions have an ability like that, and it's on a 4-turn cooldown. Now, his aura is great. Accuracy in all battles by 60. That can help out tremendously, especially in the early and the mid game of Raid Shadow Legends. Let's go glass half full for a second here, guys. 3.7 multiplier on his A1. That's very, very high. He has a 4.7, I want to say, let me double check that, 4.7 multiplier on his A2. That's a 4.6, my bad. 4.6 multiplier, really, really good for an AoE attack. And then Born to Win has a whopping 7 multiplier on a single target nuke, single target damage dealer. Wow, that's a really, really high multiplier. So impressive, very impressive on the multipliers. But his base attack, again, 1432, it's a little bit above average, but for an attack-based legendary champion, nothing to really write home about. So scalability there is going to be the main issue, not the multipliers. So that's a little glass half full, a little glass half empty. Let me give you my opinion before we show him in battle while we look at my masteries and my artifact choices. I put him in an arena build for you guys. We went with Helm Smasher as our tier 6 option, Master Hexer as well. Picked up Ruthless Ambush, picked up a Whirlwind of Death as well. I like picking up those two masteries on my arena nukers and then kind of hug the right side of the support tree. As I show the artifacts here, a pretty basic build. We need accuracy on this champion for the debuffs on his A1, A2, and his buff removal on his A3, right? So I think that he is a cool addition to the game. He's a free legendary. His books aren't out of control. The question is does he justify people putting their hard-earned books into, right? I mean, he has, you know, 5-6 levels on his A2, four levels on his A3 and then just damage on his A1. You can see I got lucky and, you know, able to save a couple books off of his A1 because I don't care about that extra damage. So good multipliers, a good arena nuker and debuffer for the early game, the mid game. Is he worth taking a 6 stars though? And putting books into for a free-to-play player out there. I don't know. Alongside maybe like a Ninja, Sill of the Drakes, Drekstar Blood Twin, champions who are accessible to everybody. I guess not Ninja anymore, but you know, putting him maybe a Vizix when you get that far into the game. I think that he could be a complimentary piece of a decent team for progression. The issue is this kit is just nothing to write home about in terms of end game scalability, right? I put him in Savage with divine crit rate, put him in crit damage on the gauntlets, attack percentage on the chest, speed on the boots. Total stats here, you're gonna see 100% crit rate, 257 crit damage, 189 speed, just shy of 4,000 on the attack and 255 on accuracy. So let's see how he does in the arena first, guys. He's okay in the dungeons for progression. He's okay in faction wars. One thing I will say about him too, another kind of, I feel like I'm being a little bit more negative than positive. I think that's pretty accurate, right? That's the case on him. He's a high elf, man. I really wish he was a Shadowkin. At the very least, if he was a Shadowkin, they're gonna be opening up the Shadowkin Faction Wars pretty soon here. You know, a lot of players are gonna need extra legendaries, extra champions in general to help them out in the faction, or the Shadowkin Faction Crypt. So I would have been more keen on, you know, building this champion for everybody if he was Shadowkin. Anyway, let's go to the arena really quickly and see what he can do in terms of being kind of a nuker on your team. Your team, I just want to see him put out some damage. I want to try the A3 again. Let's give him a second chance. You never know, that Duchess could have been just god tier billion defense. Very unlikely, but let's see. So this time we're going to go after Arbiter with his A3. Arbiter, boom. Okay, that's the damage that I was hoping for against Duchess. But again, these teams are not anything to write home about here, you know? You don't see too much Maneater in the arena. Let's go on to the next one here. Let's try to one-shot Siffy. This team, let's see, I'm not sure if we'll be fast enough. Let's see. So now, this is kind of, I want to take it off auto here. This is kind of the tiebreaker here on this A3. Is it underwhelming? Was that the aberration? What one was the aberration, the 150 or the 40k? So here we go. Debuff the enemy team. Got to be careful of Foley over there. I see you, bro.
Y'all looking at?
Let me just go ahead and reduce that turn meter a little bit here. Okay, let's go after Siffy now. This is the true test.
Surprise, surprise, motherfucker! The king is back.
Okay, that's more like it. So that's more like it. I almost, that was solid. So he can one-shot anybody if you put like a Cornelia, Prince Kaimar, basically a sleep champion, a CC champion, even a provoker ahead of him, like a Molly Tankard or something like that. So I feel like you can use him in the arena, right? Already, I feel like after those two test runs, let me try one more. I'm looking for a really tanky team again. So let's try this Siffy here and just try one more run because this is a use case for this champion, right? He can either be your arena debuffer, come back around if you don't kill everybody on your first shot, and try to just, you know, pick them off one at a time with that hard-hitting A3. Or he can just open up. Let's just try his AoE here. So this is his AoE. Boom. And you know what? That's not bad damage at all, considering everybody has access to this champion. So already, right out the gate here, guys, you can put him on an arena team, and he can be a very, very viable campaign farmer for you, or not campaign, excuse me, arena, great hall farmer for you guys. And again, this applies more to people who are just farming like gold 3, gold 4, versus, you know, pushing him to platinum. You can do way better in terms of other nukers, but this guy is 100% free. Picture starting an account today and not having, you know, these OP arena nukers out there, and you're just given this free champion. Can you use him? I would say yes. So all of a sudden, a little bit more optimistic on this champion. The reviews on this champion are absolute dirt, absolute trash, because you got to figure the first people who are building him and trying him out are just upset that he kind of sucks, especially compared to Ninja, right? I don't know what the game team has against Simple, because they made Ninja a beast and they're like, yeah, Simple could be kind of an early game version of a free limited edition champion based on a online personality.
Take it easy, champ. Why don't you stop talking for a while?
Be real with me. What do you think about putting or naming these champions after content creators outside of the raid space, you know? I'm not saying I want a champion. They already gave me Ash Walker. Really appreciate that. They gave Hell Hades. They gave him Hell Freak. I'm joking. They didn't really give us these champions. But we can pretend. We can pretend. I guess the main goal here isn't to appeal to us, the player base already. It's to appeal to their fans, right? It gives Simple and Ninja something to say on their advertisements that are probably go for way over $1 million. It gives them something to say like, hey guys, I'm in this game. Check it out because of me. I'm literally a character that you can get for free by logging in the game. So I guess to that extent, it's not a bad strategy. I'm sure it helps a lot with UA. However, you know, to me, I don't really get excited about it. Nothing against Simple or Ninja by any stretch of the imagination. I'm sure they're, or I've never met Simple, but Ninja's a good guy. And, you know, nothing against them. But it doesn't really do it for me. Does it do it for you guys? For me, I'm all about the champion. Like, what are you doing inside the game? All that other stuff, I don't really care that much. So, let's see. Reliquary needed to stay alive, thank God, to pick up Vizix here. We're at Dragon 25 right now. That Spray Shot, by the way, that A2, is that what it's called, Spray Shot? That's a pretty cool mechanic to it. I'll give him that. Scores a B plus in the mechanic and the aesthetics of the mechanic animation department. But overall here, guys, listen, I could show you this champion against every, you know, Doom Tower boss, Doom Tower wave. Where and when you're going to use him is pretty simple, right? If you need a debuffer in dungeon progression, go ahead and use him, right? A magic affinity debuffer. If you don't have, I don't know, Tayrell, if you don't have Ugo, for example, I would definitely go Ugo over him. You know, maybe use him. Maybe consider using him as your decreased defense option. The thing is most people probably already have, you know, Duck the Pierce. I could go on and on here. Probably already have. On my free-to-play, I have Duck the Pierce. So do I need to build him to be my debuffer? No. I'd rather have Duck the Pierce. He brings more to the table in terms of a debuffer, right? He has Provoke and stuff on his A3, unkillable. He has, what, Leech or decreased speed on the A1? I think Leech. So he's bringing a lot to the table, you know, more than just sheer damage. And when we talk about sheer damage, I'm really not seeing it here from Simple in PvE content. So am I going to use him anywhere in the game? Or should you guys use him anywhere in the game? I'm talking about not just my dirty pay-to-win account here. I'm talking about my free-to-play account, too. Where and when am I going to be using this guy? And honestly, nowhere outside the arena, you know? Unless you really need that decreased defense debuffer. Or unless you're going against one of those notorious teams that's all Ogryn Tribe all the time. Hey, you got a shot at removing those buffs before you attack them. And I will say, you know, if we are going to be using him as the arena, you know, especially with that A3, 7x multiplier, I mean, it's weird, right? You look at this champion as a debuffer in the arena, right? Most people probably look at him as I did first and think to themselves, well, he's going to be my, I'm going to open up with that hard-hitting A2. It did like 100k damage to some of those enemies. So we can definitely be an arena nuker for you on the A3. He can be a single target specialist on the A2, single target specialist on the A3. He can come back around and do the AoE to clean up or come do the A3 to pop off anybody he doesn't kill with his A2. So I think, again, for early game players, he's a free legendary champion. Are you going to book him up? No, I'm not going to book him out. I would say that if you are the type of person that plans on using Simple only in the arena, I don't think you're required to book him, right? Just take him to level 60, sure, but don't book him. That's what I'm going to do on my free-to-play account. I'm not going to book him because we're only ideally using the A2 and the A3 one time. Why waste your books, right? So he puts out... Jeez, I mean, Ugo freaking put out almost as much damage as him. I'm not using him PvE, man. I mean, Ugo's also a debuffer and all those heals and also an epic champion, by the way. So I think that he's pretty trash in PvE content. Hey, a speed shield, I'll keep that. Pretty trash in PvE content. Good for progression in dungeons. Good for the arena, though. So that is the bright spot. What about you guys? What do you think of this champion? Let me know in the comments below, guys. Did I miss an area of the game where you think, hey, this champion could actually help me out? I want to hear from you guys. That is my opinion. Look forward to hearing all your opinions on this champion in the description or in the comments below. Thank you for watching, and as always, take care, guys.